Hi, I'm David Sanders, and I'm going to talk about solving discrete problems using Boolean satisfiability with Julia. So I'm going to present a symbolic modeling interface for discrete problems, how to encode problems as Boolean satisfiability problems, how to solve those Boolean satisfiability problems. And this is very related to work in the Julia Constraints organization and the Constraint Programming Extensions.jl library for jump and MOI. Okay, so let's think about coloring graphs. A graph is just some vertices joined by edges. So let's suppose we have these vertices 1, 2, and 3, and these edges 1 to 2, and 2 to 3, which we can visualize like this. These graphs are plotted using lightgraphs.jl and graphplot.jl. The graph coloring problem is assign a color to each vertex such that the colors are different for vertices which are next to each other, or in other words, which are joined by an edge. We want to model this mathematically, and we're going to use symbolic variables from the great symbolics.jl package. So let's call ci the color of vertex number I. So n is going to be the length of v, in other words, the number of vertices. And we're going to define these symbolic variables c1, c2, and c3. And you can see them here, c1, c2, and c3. Those are going to be the colors at each vertex. And so we have to specify where do those colors live. We need a domain for each variable. So let's try to color the graph with two colors. K is going to be the number of colors, and here is a list of colors that we can choose from. And so we can actually write down domains in a symbolic way using the symbolics.jl package. So here's a symbolic expression that the color of vertex 1 must live inside this set of colors from 1 to 2. And so we see that the result is indeed a symbolic expression that C1 is in the set red-green, or the vector red-green. So domains here is the same thing for each of these vertices, or each color. And then we need these constraints that vertices joined by an edge cannot be the same color. So in other words, ci is not equal to cj when I and j belong in an edge. And now we're going to collect all of those constraints together. This is just a vector of all of these symbolic expressions. So this gives us what's called a constraint satisfaction problem. That's just a collection of variables with domains that they live in and constraints that join them together. So this is also called a constraint network. And now we're going to make a discrete CSP, CSP standing for constraint satisfaction problem, object from satisfiability interface.jl, this package that I wrote. We'll pass the symbolic constraints into this constructor, and it will parse these symbolic constraints into domain definitions and then the actual constraints. So now we can just call solve on this problem object, and it will return the mapping of variables to colors. And here is the result plotted on a graph. We see that indeed this vertex 2 has a different color from vertices 1 and 3. Now, suppose we had a ring graph, a graph in the form of a ring, then it's clear that we can't actually color this with two colors. So let's try. Let's set up this graph coloring problem with two colors. And the result is this unsat. That means that this system of constraints is unsatisfiable. It is not possible to satisfy all the constraints simultaneously. However, if we do the same thing with three colors now, of course, it is possible, and here is the result. Here's an example of coloring a much more complicated graph. This is a design by Boolean for the JuliaCon 2019 t-shirt, and we took this Penrose tiling and colored it using a graph coloring algorithm. This runs in under 1 second with this tool. So far it seems very magical. How do we actually solve these problems? One way to do so is to encode. Okay, so how do we actually solve these problems? So far it's just seemed very magical. One way to do so is to encode the discrete problem to a Boolean satisfiability problem, SAT. That means we're just going to have Boolean variables. So a simple way to encode a variable x which lives in the domain 1 to n, integers 1 to n, is to use n Boolean variables, x1 up to xn, and with the constraint that exactly one of the xi must be true. So let's see what that looks like when we encode the problem. We get these clauses, which are ors. This v is an or symbol. So c1, 1 is true, or c1, 2 is true. c1, 1 means that the color of vertex 1 is the first color, and c1, 2 means that it's the second color. So that either of those must be true because it has to have one of the two colors. But similarly, we don't want it to have both colors simultaneously, and so we have that either not C11 or not C12. So we can code all of the constraints in this way as just this long sequence of Boolean statements. And the amazing thing is that there are actually solvers to solve these problems. This is called a SAT problem, and it's a standard CNF form. It stands for conjunctive normal form, which is a conjunction or AND of clauses, and each clause is an OR. Here it is written out in a numerical way. So we've converted from the symbolic representation to the numerical representation. Again, this means Boolean variable number one or Boolean variable number two is true, and Boolean variable number one is false or Boolean variable number two is false. And we go through all of the clauses like that. And so now we pass this whole problem to a so-called SAT solver. So the Boolean satisfiability problem is NP complete. In general, we expect it to take exponential time in the size of the input, but it can actually be solved efficiently in many cases by a SAT solver. And these can now handle up to millions of Boolean variables. They're usually written in C or C++. So for example, there's a popular one called PicoSat that is wrapped by the PicoSat.jl package. And satisfiability interface.jl currently uses the crypto minisat 5 solver by default, but it's easy to add other solvers. In fact, I actually wrote a very simple SAT solver in pure Julia, which implements the so-called DPLL algorithm from 1962. It's meant to be pedagogical and be a basis for making a more complete solver, but it seems to be performant for small systems, which should not surprise anybody who's used to Julia. Julia should be an excellent language to write such solvers in. So here's an example. You just do using SimpleSATSolver, and when you have a SAT problem type object, you can just solve it using SimpleSAT, using type-based dispatch. Okay, so what is the algorithm for solving Boolean satisfiability problems? You just start assigning variables to either true or false, basically at random, and each time you assign a variable, you check if it violates any of the constraints. And if it does, you backtrack, you undo that choice of variable, and you choose the opposite. Then there's a very important tool called unit propagation that says that if you have a clause with two variables, X or Y, and you know that X is false, then you know that Y must be true. And so that enables you to reduce a lot the search space where you're looking. Using the same kind of techniques, we can also solve discrete numerical problems. So for example, here's a problem where we have variables X, which is in 1, 2, Y is in 2, 5, Z is in 3, 7, and we're constraining a Z to be equal to X times Y. So again, we set up the constraint satisfaction problem and we solve it, and we see the solution is x equals 2, z equals 4, and y equals 2. In fact, we can find all the solutions. These are all of the possible solution sets of this system of equations given those constraints. And for example, I can go back and now add a new constraint, which is that x is not equal to 1. And Pluto will recalculate, and these, I excluded the solutions where x was equal to 1. So basically, encoding to SAT is actually a very powerful paradigm for solving all kinds of discrete problems. And our work aims to make this accessible from Julia using these packages, satisfiability interface.jl and SimpleSATSolver.jl. Thanks for your attention.